It's an amazing pleasure to be here. The new house and this new arrangements, right? I got a little bit lost when we got here. And a week before our event here in Maryland too, so it's really, I think, appropriate for us to talk about this topic of work and work under new light. As I usually like to say, perhaps what I will bring here is nothing new to many of you. I would say more a refresher on many of the concepts, but it's good for us to receive the reminders every now and then. As I like to say personally, we come to in contact with spirits because we need to be reminded every single day. In work, sometimes we think that it's something astronomical that we have to do or we have to make. But it's quite the opposite. Sometimes, as John Leon just mentioned in the opening message that we received, it's something small, perhaps to rule out the evil inside of us. Something as simple as that. All that it takes in this reincarnation, I'm not saying for all of us here, but for an individual sometimes, is to switch the negative with the positive. And we think that is, you know, do great works as Divaldo Frankl does, Chico Xavier, Mother Teresa. That time will come when we are prepared. But we have to take baby steps. So what we'd like to do today is to kind of help us change this perception that we have of work and kind of redirect ourselves in the right path as far as the idea of work, service, how we choose and what we choose, the amount that we choose. So when we get out of here today and we have to face the world out there, especially when we go to work on Mondays or go to school for the children, we see it a different way. Just recently, we celebrated Labor Day. And Labor Day is the first Monday in September, is a creation of the labor movement and is dedicated to the social and economic achievements of American workers. It constitutes a yearly national tribute to the contribution workers have made to the strength, prosperity, and well-being of the country. A couple of key words here, towards the end right there. Celebrating the contribution workers have made to the strength, prosperity, and well-being of the country. Just that alone, we can see that work, any type of work, promotes just that. Strength, prosperity, and well-being of the country. We're talking about a community, right? We're talking about a group of people that is ruled, they're guided under certain rules, certain regulations, laws, and we will talk about laws as well. And obeying these laws, doing the things that we have to do, we bring prosperity to ourselves. We bring growth. We bring a lot of complaining, but after we get it done, we see that there's a good result. Hopefully there's a good result when we do the right thing. Excuse me. Just so we don't ignore the picture, this is an illustration of the first Labor Day parade in September, New York, September 5th, 1882. I believe this is, if I'm not mistaken, a year before the Labor Day became a national event for the whole country, for the whole movement. So just a beautiful picture of New York City in this parade. And we celebrate. Funny enough that, you know, this past Labor Day, we were, you know, asking people and listening to people, you know, what did you do? And we see that people on Labor Day, you know, the idea is what? I'm going to rest, I'm going to stay home. But some individuals, they're working, they have to work. And that's funny because we think that work is when we go in with labor. But what about for those who stay home? What do they do? You think they worked or not? So what is work? What is work for us? So when we have to get up in the morning and we have to take care of ourselves, is that work? When we have to take care of somebody else, that's work, right? When we have to take care of the house. If we have to get up in the morning and study for something, that's work. And we'll kind of redirect our minds on that a little bit more. But just remember this part, because we have this idea that, you know, Labor Day is just to rest, but we still work. We still have to produce. And Jesus himself, in certain occasions, said, look, my Father who is in heaven is working. I have to work as well. We have to always produce and work. But we hold that thought for a moment. We talk about walls, right? Form walls, form guidance, so that we have strength, prosperity, and well-being. I would like to touch a little bit on this aspect, along with spiritism. Divine laws, the third part of the spirit book, and it's an amazing part, dear to my heart, because it touches on the divine laws. It starts explaining the divine laws, and then it starts with the law of worship, work, as you see highlighted there, reproduction, preservation, destruction, social law, progress, law of equality, liberty, justice, love, and compassion, which encompasses all of them. It's a lot to read, it's a lot to digest, and we urge everyone to take the time to read little by little. Go back to it, because you will find, every time you read, you will find things that it's like, oh my gosh, I never thought about this, or never seen it this way. The same works with the law of work. But before we dive into the idea of law, because it's a divine law, let's try to understand what we have as law for ourselves. What do we understand as law? If we go to the dictionary, we'll see that law is the principles and regulations established in a community by some authority and applicable to its people, whether in the form of legislation or of custom and policies recognized and enforced by judicial decision. Principles and regulations. Principles and regulations. And then second, any written or positive rule or collection of rules prescribed under the authority of the state or nation as by the people in its constitution compared by law, special law, so on and so forth. What we're trying to bring here to follow, that law is not something that is created, hopefully not, it's not something that is created to make people mad. For example, we get out of the street over here, it's not, the stop sign was not put there or placed in that corner to make us mad, to make us upset. It's bring what? Guidance. That if I don't have the stop sign, number one, I'm not gonna be called, my attention will not be called with a huge red thing to say stop. And if I don't stop, somebody else on the other side may be crossing the road and hit my car or hit somebody else. And there are a lot of consequences with this idea, you see? But most of us, or many of us, like to think that that red sign is to say what? Leo, you're running late, I'm just gonna make you mad. You're running late, so you have to stop. Or the lights, right? Or anything else. Time, when we have to get to certain places in time, when we have to be doing certain things, and we think that these laws or these guidance or to make us mad. That is not the intention. That is not the intention. Without which, we would feel freely, as we like to think, however, with no respect and no responsibility, consequently. Because we want to do whatever we want to do, we think that we can accomplish things the way we want to accomplish, and that's it, right? There is no ifs and buts. So that's the idea behind this whole thing. That's the idea behind law. And I think we grasp it to quite a bit nowadays, especially in this country, compared to some other countries where laws are applicable to some and not applicable to others. Laws are not well respected by a well majority, and they have to revise their constitutions. They have to analyze their laws and rules that they have, because sometimes they're very abusive as well, and they don't respond to the majority. Again, just for us to see the guidance. Now, if this is our law, if this is our constitution, or as we see here, a written or positive rule or collection of rules prescribed by our government, how do we think, how can we analyze the divine laws? And again, divine laws here is not only prescribed to planet Earth, to this environment here, it's to the universe. It is created by our Creator, right? Supreme, just, divine laws. They're also the guidance for all of us in the whole universe. We may see the law work here in a different way because of our level of adjustment to these laws, for lack of better words, but they're applicable everywhere. And we need to remember this, because later on we're going to talk about a topic that is really interesting, that we think that perhaps when we evolve, become pure spirit, i.e. Jesus, or many other enlightened spirits, that we don't need to work anymore. Quite the opposite. We work even more. So there it is. These laws, they are in our conscience, calling us every single day, especially in this moment now that we're going through this transitional, these different transitions, that we're questioning a lot of things. Is this important for me? Is this important for my brother and sister? So we're being called, our conscience, there is no need for my partner to come to me and say, this is wrong. We feel bad. We have that burden inside of us that this is not right. So again, let us look into these divine laws as guidance. And the law of work is the same. It's to guide us. So labor, work, is something that is inside of us. The need to produce, the need to bring prosperity to ourselves is something that is inside of us. And in this chapter of the Gospel, of the Spirit's book, we'll see this beautiful question that Kardec asked the spirits. Is work a requirement of the law of nature? And the wise mind said, work is a law of nature, which is proved by the fact that it is necessary for survival and that the maintenance of civilization requires that you perform it. Through work, you provide for both your needs and your enjoyments. Very applicable to us right now, right? Because when we look at enjoyments right now, we see the materialistic needs that we tend to connect with. That's what brings enjoyment, right? If we were to ask the kids like the phone, if we like a dog, we like the car, like the house, or take care of certain things, and we see that these are enjoyments. And in order for us to obtain these enjoyments, we need to do what? We need to work. We need to make money to pay for the cost of these things, these material goods. Now, how will it be, this is just a question, we're not going to get into it, how will it be for spirits that perhaps don't need anymore the material needs that we think we need? They still have to work to get them. Even though they're not as materialistic, they still have to work. We see the level of necessity here, and this brings to a point, will bring us hopefully to a point at the end of the talk. The next question is very interesting, and this kind of summarizes the whole thing, but there's more. We like to complicate things, but we can lead with this, and that would, in a way, be enough. Should we understand that work only defines material limitations? We talked about early here on the day of Labor Day, right, when we celebrate. Is it only that I have to go to work to consider myself working? Listen to what the higher mind said. No, the spirit works just as the body does. Every sort of use of occupation is work. That summarizes everything. That is guides us into a different understanding of what we think work is. For the kids again, right? When we go to school, we're working. It's the first levels of work. Even before that, we can say the little babies, when they're collecting their toys, right, after they play, that's work. It's useful. Something playing is useful because it activates our minds. It activates our brain. Dancing is useful. It's work. Look how beautiful this is. It changed the concept completely of everything that we do. When we are praying, that's work. Let us think this way. We are the commanding chief of trillions and trillions of selves. And we are now choosing different thoughts, different feelings. When John Bianchi's mentioned in the message earlier today, to rule out the evil, to exchange the negative with the positive, that alone is work. And whatever vibration you are feeling or replacing inside of ourselves, what will happen to these feelings of self? They will correspond to it. And they will get the guidance of positive things. And that is work. And what's going to happen to these feelings of self? They will vibrate the same way. Then when something comes to harm them, naturally they will work for the best. That's why when we are stressed, when we are tired, and we come in contact with someone perhaps who has a little tiny bit of cold, or the last of their cold, we get very sick. Because our minds are not, or our bodies are not responding to something positive. We're not working properly. Even though we want to, we're fighting, we're doing everything we can, but we're not there yet. But this, again, summarizes this idea of work. But there is more to this idea of work. When we come in contact with this whole chapter, and we will see as well, it is the quality of work, the quantity of work, who are we working with, right? Because we think that sometimes, as we said at the beginning, work is something miraculous, something huge that we have to make, that, oh my God, this is a good worker, just because the person accomplishes a whole lot. Great, it is. But what about the small things of life and how we do things, how we present ourselves to the world? A beautiful passage that we find in this book, Our Father, by Mimi, from the hands of Chico Xavier, chapter 5, it's called The Happiness and Duties. It's a story of John, son of Zebedee. And John, in the way to accomplish something for his father, sees Jesus and tells Jesus that, look, I need to get something done for my father. It was a four-day trip, kind of quote unquote, work that he had to do for his father. And it was a day, the day that he had to leave, it was a day for them to go up and out and, you know, kind of like a weekend for us. And he was really upset. And Jesus sees the whole thing, that he wasn't so happy, even though he was responsible and he was quite courageous to accomplish whatever he had to do. He went, he took off, did whatever he had to do, came back after 4 days, and when he came back, he noticed not only that John was still upset and kind of, you know, in that contradictory feeling, and so was Zebedee as well, the father. He was really upset because both of them, even though the task was accomplished, both of them were upset. And Jesus then came to John and said, John, what's happening? I'm paraphrasing here because it's hard to to bring the words of Maymay. And he said, what happened? What happened to you? And he obviously explains the whole situation, and he asked John again, look, wasn't the task accomplished? Yes. Didn't you help our father by helping your father? Look at this. Helping our father, our creator, by helping your father. Yes, everything done was done as it was requested. And then Jesus turns back to him and said, there's one more thing to do. It's for you to be happy by having attended the request of our Father. We should have no right to make anybody upset or be upset because of the things that we have to do. Again, be happy with the task that we have to do. Just do it from the heart. And it's an invitation because it's a beautiful thing nowadays because we tend to do things that, okay, I have to do this, I have to, you know, we look at work in this very difficult way that I have to accomplish, I have to pay this, I have to get this done, and we forget the aim, the goal of this combination of tasks that we have with our feelings, with our thoughts as well. So the invitation stands. Let us do it with happiness. Let us do it in an educated way. And we think as well that when we accomplish something, when we do something, that, you know, I can just sit here and things will happen. I can just pray and things will happen. And Jesus was quite direct when he said, if you help yourself, then heaven will come to your aid. In Matthew 7, we'll find these two beautiful teachings. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. He who seeks finds, and to find who knocks, the door will be opened. We have to go out. We have to be active. Joanna DeAngelis reminds us that besides prayer, work is a necessity, is a must, and one without the other, we don't accomplish anything. We do not accomplish anything. And we'll see an illustration of this towards the end, I promise. Which of you, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, he will give him a snake. If you then, thought you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? It's easy for us to look at this passage and say, okay, let's just give freely. Let's just make our friend's life easier. It is true, we have to make our lives easier by handling the things that perhaps we don't have a necessity for. Or perhaps if we can give something to someone, it's a necessity for us as well, it's a must for us. But we have to remember one thing. It's important to ask. We also have to ask. And ask even for the opportunity to work. Not necessarily that we're going to knock on everybody's door and say, I want to work. If there is a necessity for that, let's go ahead and do it. If we need work, we have to apply for, you know, send applications for a new job, right? So we have to ask. But the thing is to be available, to be present, to say, here I am. I'm knocking on the door. My door is open as well. If you need to come to me, let us do it. The other thing is this, is that we have to teach one another how to fish the fish. Yes, there is no other way that we will teach a child, and we see this in not so well developed countries, a child who is hungry, they need to do what before they learn? They need to eat. They have to have bread. But after they have the bread, what do we need to do? We then apply the teachings. It's a consequence, little by little. So we need to distinguish, what do we need to do first? What's the first need of that individual? Because we think that the immediate education is everything. But in giving, in working, is an education for the individual who is providing it, and for the individual who is receiving it as well. So just something for us to remind ourselves that the necessity of knocking for this law. I'd like to jump to towards the end of this chapter of the law of work from the Spirit's book. And there's this beautiful passage that Kardec brings to us talking about work and how much is necessary in the need of work. And it's a little bit long, but we'll try to dissect into pieces so we can work together. This is our next discussion towards the end of the chapter. To say that it's necessary to work is not to make a complete statement of the subject. The worker must also be able to find work, and this is not always possible. Unfortunately, when work is not available, deprivation soon falls. This is an evil that for which economists are constantly seeking a remedy in the balance of production and consumption. But this balance, supposing it to be attainable, will always be subject to fluctuations, and during the intervals, the worker must leave. What happened a couple years ago to the economy, to our economy? Went down, right? Everything went down the tubes, to keep it simple. You know, we said, you know, the government was saying, oh, everything's perfect, everything is perfect. Then the bubble started hitting here and there, affecting all of us because we think that we're independent. We're not. In this global market nowadays, we're very interconnected, and we will get more interconnected than way before. That we, one country produced way a lot of this, now things are more balanced. And the other will need a little less than this or a little more than this. Things are much balanced nowadays. And because of that balance, which is good, we're more interconnected. The same way we can use the example of a family members, right? Do children need the parents? They do. Do parents need their children? They do. Otherwise, they wouldn't be following, as we saw in the beginning, the law of what? Society. Starts from home. You see how interconnected we are, these different bodies. This is a statistic from the labor force statistics from the current population survey. And this right here is the unemployment rate. We see here in 2005, and then 2008, and then 2010, and what happened to us, you know, up to January of this year. Kind of things decline a little bit. And that again is unemployment. The ability of someone being unemployed or being registered, you know, employed by someone, there's, I think the, when we really put the different aspects of being unemployed in this chart, I think things would be all the way up here, you know, way more than the 10% mark that the government was aware about. I'm not trying to bring politics, but we need to understand that there's this fluctuation. And this was written by Kardec, the end of the 1800s, right? And we're still talking about the same thing, this curve, these different curves. It happens. And it may happen again if we don't watch, if we don't open ourselves to a more free market. So for us, this is just for us to understand. So what does Kardec then bring as an antidote to this? This brings us to an element that has not been considered enough. Education. There it is. We speak here not only of the education of the mind, but also of the character and the habit. Education itself being the totality of acquired habits. One of the elders said, good habits, virtues, right, that we also have. Every day, large numbers of people enter society who have no principles and nothing with which to curb their instincts. This being so, we can hardly wonder at the disastrous consequences that fall in their way. Once properly educated, however, these individuals will bring into their lives, daily lives, habits of order, an ability to plan for themselves and their dependents, and a degree of respect for the rights of others that will allow them to endure periods of difficulty with greater ease. Laxness and inability to plan to the future can only be understood and cured through sound instruction. Universal education is, then, the starting point for and the essential element of our social well-being, the one pledge of security for all of us. Ethics, right? We talk about ethics in the workplace. We talk about the book of ethics, the ethics books, whatever, when we are working for a large corporation. At school as well, they have their guidelines, the things that we have to do. How do we conduct ourselves properly? Education. Being educated. It's beautiful when we have work, right? Everything is so well. But when that individual does not have the proper education to conduct themselves in that workplace, in that environment, what happens?
Big mess.
Destruction. And we can go on. People will get offended. All their things, corruption, right? All of these things will happen. So is the problem with inability of work? When we have work as well, we have to look for that opportunity as the greatest opportunity ever. The greatest thing we have in our daily lives. Not only by that employer to say, oh, I love my boss. I never say that. We never say that. I'm just joking.
I do too.
After these studies, believe me, I do too. So thank you. But we look at it and say, God has placed not only the work, but the people that I work with, so I can work with them. God has placed the ability that I have to exchange my labor, my service, so I can have money, so I can provide for myself, for my family, the prosperity that we talked about at the beginning of the talk, the order that we talked about. Now we're looking at things much different than before, not only towards the idea of work, but how I need to respect this capability that I have to produce something. And look at myself and say, look, I can do this, I can accomplish this. And then we go to school and we do even better. And then we learn new skills and we do even better. And then we share things the way we do with people. And people surprise you. And we're talking about this this week in this first of Baltimore when we're studying. You show a task to someone that you know you need to do so, and the person comes to you and say, why don't you do this way? And you look at it, wow, I never thought about that way. You learn new things, right? Again, that constantly exchange of knowledge that we have, and we develop this idea of ethics. There's way more to talk about this whole thing of ethics, on how, you know, not only the little companies or the little institutions or the great institutions in that country, how they produce things, but also now the exchange of different companies on how countries accept certain products or certain things, lobbying or not. And it goes all the way back to this concept of education, right? When you mentioned about the corruption, we see things happening, but it's like, this is so easy. Just do, it's a 1-2-3 thing. Why are we taking to these extremes? But the greed that we have inside of us, the need to provide only for ourselves, thinking that we are better than the other. So this is the education that Kardec is talking about. This is the need that we have to look at it and say, okay, we tend to think that living in a planet that is more evolved than Earth, that everybody will be in a socialism type of mentality, right? Everybody gets paid the same. Everybody have the same riches, everybody have the same knowledge, everybody have in the same level.
Why?
No. It doesn't work that way. It does not
work that way. I don't know why there is that. Sameness is not the rule. Sameness doesn't have to be the rule.
Right.
And I think the correlation with the effort is more like.
Exactly. The effort is very good, yes, you're right. The idea we see here is that we need to differentiate ourselves from one another. Acceptance that we're different. Acceptance that we're different. Are we going to reach the level of perfect being? Yes, we will. If we can give an example, just to illustrate this. Joanna de Angelis, since we have her as a mentor and we read a passage from here, in Emmanuel. Beautiful minds. We don't know. I'm not here to describe their level when, you know, of pureness or evolution. But they're two tremendous mentors for all of us. They bring love in such a different way that brings us to the idea of love. And it is incontestable that they bring the idea of love. They touch our hearts in their own ways, right? And the same thing is that when we go and perhaps ascend to a better place, or we help this planet into a planet of regeneration, that everything will be the same. No, we will still have a difference. We still have people who will take care of a great sum of money, right? A great sum of riches, because they can. A lot of them, they can much better than us manage the sums of money, manage the sum not only of money, of wealth, as we understand, but also different types of wealth. Work, an example. We see examples of, in many of the Andrea Luis's books, especially Muscular, which we'll touch a little bit about it, of the ministers. We think that being a minister would be something to have the life. No, they work more than everybody else. They work more than everybody else. So, education. Talking about this idea of being rich, have more than others. Are the rich example from the law of work?
No.
Very simple way. Because Kardec here, he's feeding the mentality that we still have with these questions, saying, is rich just the materialistic rich that we have? Is that everything? The answer is quite simple. For material work, perhaps, but not from the obligation of becoming useful according to their means and of developing their own intelligence and that of others, which is work itself. Given much, you have a greater amount of time for doing good. So, if in the next reincarnation we come back very wealthy, remember, you don't have to work physically, but you have to activate your brain. Remember, the body needs to be activated, right? Your goodness and the good of others as well. We have to make sure that we're doing our part. And there's much work to be done when you have that wealth, when you have that job security. Because sometimes you become an individual, you know, I'm set for life. I have the perfect job. I have the perfect life. Okay, so what are you doing now that you conquered? And good job, you have done the right thing. But what are you doing now that you have that capability? And to another topic that is very important for us, the limits of work. Should we rest? That's a good point. And this is something that I always like to remember when I'm studying this part of work, because there's the other extreme of work. People who use work as an excuse. How many times have we come across that? Several times. We don't want to deal with something, We hide ourselves behind the task that we have to do, right? Oh, I don't want to deal with this person, it's going to work. I don't want to, you know, the boss is coming, we hide behind the work. You finally hide yourself behind the work. So it's important for us as well to bring balance to our lives. And this is being in the moment. Called simply being in the moment. You at work, you pay attention to work. You at home, you're doing something at home, you pay attention to what you're doing at home, whatever task you're doing. At the center, at wherever you are, you have that moment. You don't use one to upset the other. Sometimes you have to do it to readjust things that perhaps you didn't do the past day, but it's okay. Give yourself that a lot of time, get it done at that time. Otherwise, your brain will just go someplace else. And the quality will suffer. The other people around you will suffer. But going back to this idea of limited work, since rest is always required after work, is it also in law of nature? Rest restores strength to the body, and it is necessary in order to give a little more freedom to the mind, enabling it to raise itself above matter. The necessity that we have to die every single day, to go back, and before actually we go back, we do intelligent sleep. Right, we pray, and please, my mentor, my dear mentor, take me to high grounds, you know. I want to learn new things. I want to do perhaps a little more that I can in the spirit realm. And as we're doing, we're recharging our physical bodies, as it's saying here, so we can live, get up in the morning, and be well determined to do whatever we have to do. And the thing is, in the spiritual level that we are, we have to understand that even if we lose our physical body, we still have what? Our spiritual body. As dense as it is, and we also need rest. We'll see this in many of the teachings that we have from different authors, from different spiritual authors, saying that we need to rest. We need this moment that the whole mind is calming and all. Many spirits, when they are brought to talk to a counselor through a medium, in a music medium, they were in a state of sleep because they need to rest. Rest from the difficulties that they were living, and sometimes, or a lot of the times, after the conversation, they feel fatigued and they need to rest, so that the mind can digest the information that they receive. So the rest is something that we all need. Perhaps one day, as we grow older here on physical earth, we see that the children need the number of a lot of hours of sleep, and then as the individual grows, less and less. Sometimes talking to my father, he's not at home. He goes to bed 10 o'clock and he gets up at 4. And sometimes he